Hello and welcome to World Today. I'm your host, Sharmeen Ali. Various developments have been taking place in the recent days, as we have seen in the Persian Gulf. The situation is not looking very promising going forward. There are increasing tensions in the Persian Gulf. Naturally, the British warships being sent to the Persian Gulf, to the Strait of Hormuz, and the tankers that have been almost seized by the Iranis. And then previous to that, a month before, a lot of these things started happening, which we will get into a discussion later on in the program today. But most recently, on Sunday, on his televised address, President Hassan Rouhani of Iran said that he's ready to have talks with the U.S. at any time, provided that the sanctions are relieved. So this is where we stand right now, and the U.S. is still taking its position that it wants Iran to have a tougher nuclear deal and stop its proxies in the Persian Gulf. Also in this program, we will be discussing how the Kartarpur corridor talks took place over the weekend. And this was in Wagha border, where 80% of the details were ironed out between the Pakistani and Indian sides. Now, at the end of the program, as usual, we'll have our usual segment on the stock market watch. So stay with us and we'll have that towards the end. So let's begin our program today, and we'll speak to our guest, who is a Middle Eastern expert and an Arab journalist, Mr. Abdurrahman Matar. Thank you so much for joining us today on our program,
Thank
Mr.
you.
Matar. First of all, let's begin with what has just recently happened. The U.S. administration says that it is open to negotiations with Iran on a more far-reaching agreement on nuclear and other issues. And Iran has made their talks conditional on being able to export as much oil as it did before the U.S. withdrew from the nuclear pact in 2018. So where, Mr. Matar, do you see the situation standing right now? Is it a complete standstill? Is there any room for maneuvering or negotiation right now?
There should be always a room for negotiations, and I think the statements we are hearing from Iran and from the United States in the same time, it gives an impression that both of them, United States and Iran, both of them are ready to talk to each other. But if we look carefully to what they are saying, that there is a conditions on both of the sides.
Yes.
So I think unless somebody else plays a mediation role between the United States and Iran, there will be no negotiations, direct negotiations. And I think the European Union, they have a very big and good chance to play that mediation role. We have seen in the past, in the very recent past, the advisor of the French president visits Iran, and definitely France knows exactly what the United States wants. That effort seems to be failed, but especially today, there is a very important meeting taking place in Brussels in which the foreign ministers of the European Union are meeting, and they are discussing mainly the current situation in the Arabian Gulf and the conflict between the United States and Iran. Mm. Maybe the European Union will be able to come up with some sort of, you know, ideas or some sort of suggestions for the United States and for Iran. I think when United States and Iran, when both of them are ready to talk directly to each other, that gives an impression that the situation is going to ease, but still we need somebody to play in between them.
Right. So meanwhile, a joint statement by France, Britain and Germany said on Sunday that they are preoccupied by the tensions in the Persian Gulf, and time has come to act responsibly and de-escalate the tension and resume the talks. And at the same time, President Trump has said last week that U.S. sanctions would be increased substantially. So they're right now giving opposing statements. It doesn't seem as if he's willing to relent on any of his on his stand right now. And on top of that, a lot of other developments, very interesting developments, are also taking place. Britain's ambassador to Washington there was a leaked wire that said that he believed U.S. President Trump backed out of the Iran agreement because it was part of President Obama's policies. So there's a bit of confusion as far as where is this all coming from. But yes, you're saying that the European powers want to play a role in mediating these tensions. But as far as President Trump is concerned, there doesn't seem to be very much room for negotiation there.
Just let me go back quickly to the statement you have just mentioned, which was issued yesterday by Germany, Britain and France. This is the headline of today's meeting, by the way, in Brussels. The statement itself gives the impression that what are the foreign ministers of the European Union are going to discuss today and what kind of strategy or maybe effort they are trying to play in the future. And this is very important, by the way, because European countries, and especially those three countries, they are the main partners to the Iranian nuclear deal, which was signed in 2015. So definitely they have a responsibility to protect that deal. And there is a lot of interest for Europe in that deal as well. So we have to keep this in mind. So hopes is there that the European Union will be able to play some kind of a mediation role. Coming back to the point regarding the leaked information of the British ambassador in the United States. What exactly the British ambassador said in those leaks? It is exactly what Trump himself said in his election campaign. Donald Trump, during his one-year election campaign, he was continuously targeting President Obama. And he said it very clearly, and he promised his voters very clearly that he will relinquish the nuclear deal with Iran. And there is also just a few days back, there is another example of Trump's way of understanding the situation, the things, and dealing with the issues. Just a few days back, he was talking about the Obama's administration's decision not to give Turkey anti-missile system, which pushed Turkey to buy those anti-missile systems from Russia. Mm-hmm. And he was blaming President Obama openly, and he was criticizing his administration openly. So let us be very clear on Trump's administration's point of view and policies. It is very clear policy. He is doing what he already promised his voters. And I think this also gives a chance to the others, to the opponents to the United States, to Iran especially, to understand President Trump's and his administration. And I'm sure if anybody studies his statements and his what they
it's
are doing,
time for
policies,
a break. We'll be
it will
right
be easier
it's
for
time
them
for
to
a
deal
break.
With.
We'll be back. Welcome back. We were discussing with our guest Abdurrahman Matar about the situation in the Persian Gulf at the moment and the situation between U.S. and Iran at the moment. Mr. Matar, we were discussing how the European parties that were part of the JCPOA have made a joint statement on Sunday. We were just speaking about that before the break, and they've said that the time has come to act responsibly. Now, what exactly do they mean by act responsibly? What measures can be taken by both sides to act responsibly? The European Union did try to get around the strict conditions that were placed by the United States to try and bypass those sanctions for Iran and to purchase Iran oil, but that didn't work. And companies did not want to deal with Iran if they were going to be limited with the trade and the economic ties that they could have with the United States. So that approach didn't work to try and get around these measures. So what can the European countries do in order to help them in acting responsibly? And also they said that they need to take into consideration the impact and the consequences of what might happen in the Persian Gulf at the moment.
If we look carefully to the tone of the European Union, and especially the statement you are referring to, and today's statements, mm-hmm. I was just listening to on the sideline of the Brussels meeting, it gives an impression that as if the European countries, and especially those three countries, are doing their best to pursue Iran to come to the direct negotiations with the United States. Because we all understand that the United States is the superpower. European Union is less power than United States. And in a way or another, there is some kind of, understanding, we can say, between United States and the European Union. The pressure is more on Iran, actually. the French advisor, the French president's advisor who visited Tehran a few days back, he was trying his best to convince the Iranians to come to the negotiation table with the United States. I think, you know, European Union will be mounting more pressure on Iran. I think the result of the French advisor visit to Iran was the statement you are referring to, the statement of Iranian president you was just referring to. In a way or another, European Union will try its best to convince Iran to come to the negotiations with some kind of promises that, okay, the best of the 2015 agreement will be there. Just come, try to improve your conditions, try to improve some sort of your stance with the United States. What actually the United States wants from Iran, to me and to most of the people who are, you know, watching carefully what's happening in the Middle East, in the last maybe 13 or 14 years, Iran expanded too much in the Middle East. It is in Iraq fully, it is in Syria, it is in Yemen, it is in Bahrain, it is somewhere else in Lebanon as well. The most dangerous place for the United States and for its main ally in the Middle East, Israel, is Syria. I think Americans are doing their best to push the Iranian back out of Syria, remain in Iraq, remain in Yemen, remain in Lebanon up to some limit, it's okay, but not Syria. Syria is a very important place for Israel, for United States as well. And the dangerous part of the Iranian presence in Syria is that because of Iran, Russia is there now. Mm. And that really makes the situation in the Middle East more complicated, and especially for Israel, especially for the United States. So I think in a way or another, United States is trying to push the Iranian out of Syria.
Okay, let's talk now about the situation in the Strait of Hormuz, because that seems to be a key place where a lot of things are happening. Mm-hmm. First of all, now a second British warship has been sent there when a British tanker was approached by Iranian vessels, and then they were sent away by the warship that was already there. And then also the British ships have raised their threat levels to critical level 3. So this is another escalation that's going on over there, and the British are also in a very tough situation with their tankers going and coming. Now, Iran has also said that if our oil cannot be transported and cannot be shipped across to other countries, then no other country's oil will be. So let's talk about what's happening over there right now. Well, can you tell us a bit about your insights about that region, the Strait of Hormuz, what's going on over there with the warships and everything like that?
The peak of the Iranian-American conflict we can see in two places, actually. One is the Strait of Hormuz, the other one inside Saudi Arabia itself. Mm-hmm. Since the United States increased its pressure on Iran, Iran tried its best to, you know, push back or ease that pressure in a way or another. We have seen that the Houthi in Yemen, who are supported by the Iranians, are, you know, increasing their attacks inside Saudi Arabia. In the same time, as you just said, Iranian promised the Iranian leadership, they have given a promise to their own people that if United States is not allowing us to export oil, then nobody will be allowed to export oil from the Strait of Hormuz. We have seen series of happenings, I can say, in Strait of Hormuz. In the first attack, there was four UAE's ships were attacked in the Strait of Hormuz with a very minor attacks. And then we have seen the British Navy is, you know, arresting or unsealing an Iranian oil tanker. We have seen now more increase and more escalation in the situation when Britain is sending its another warship. Things will be complicated. It will be more complicated. This is the reflection of the political type of a conflict which mm-hmm. is taking place between Iran and the United States. Keep in mind that more interesting is the situation in the Strait of Hormuz. Unfortunately, nobody is concerned much about the attack, the daily attacks inside Saudi Arabia, which is again a reflection of the Iranian anger. Mm-hmm. This is a very dangerous situation mm-hmm. because definitely the attacks inside Saudi Arabia by the Houthis, it will have its own reaction, whether it is now or maybe after some time. unfortunately, the actions in the Strait of Hormuz seems to be more, you know, important for the rest of the world, because this is the main strait where oil experts, oil exports are passing through.
All the Middle Eastern countries, with the exception of Oman, the oil that's coming from there has to pass through the Strait of Hormuz, basically.
Yeah, but no, but Saudi Arabia, they have also another option, because Saudi Arabia, they have they can export from the sea, the Red Sea as well, which is on the exactly other part of the Arab Peninsula. But what I'm trying to say is that Strait of Hormuz is very important, because, as you know, India, China, Japan, South Korea, all these Eastern countries especially, they depend mainly on the oil coming from Strait of Hormuz. So definitely, in a way or another, there is a try to involve those countries as well to mount more pressure on Iran. Let us remember that in the nuclear deal, which was signed in 2005, Russia and China is part of that agreement. So there is some sort of a responsibility. The Iranians are trying in a way or another to tell these countries, come and involve, face the United States, stand with us against the United States. You are a part of that deal.
Yes, exactly. And okay, so let's speak now about the timeline. What, going backwards, you've given a bit of what has happened in the past. A month ago, okay, we know that a year back, America backed out of the agreement, the JCPOA agreement. A month ago, Japan's Prime Minister, Mr. Abe, visited Iran for proposal of talks. But Iran's Supreme Leader, Ayatollah Ali Khamenei, said that Iran has no trust in America. So that didn't come through. And at the same time, while he was still in Tehran, two tankers were attacked, and one of them was a Japanese-owned company. And this was also in the Strait of Hormuz, and Iran denied responsibility for that attack. So this is like sort of building up for everything. And then after that, Iran has said that it's going to abrogate parts of the nuclear deal, increase the uranium enrichment beyond 300 kilograms, and the percentage of uranium that's required to make, that can be built up to a nuclear bomb. So then eventually the U.S. has also sent 1,000 more troops to the region. And now on the 20th of June, Iran's Revolutionary Guard shot down a U.S. military drone. So the situations have been escalating quite a bit. So now, Iran's Revolutionary Guard is mainly the presence in the Strait of Hormuz and in that region. And they're under direct control of Ayatollah Ali Khamenei directly, right? So now, Iran drones and missiles have also struck pipelines and airports in Saudi Arabia, like you've said, through their proxies, and U.S. bases in Iraq and things like that. So a lot of other things are going on the sidelines. And then Iran is also threatening to unleash a tide of refugees through opening up its borders from Afghanistan into Europe. So a lot of these things are very threatening. And one UAE official said that, I've never seen Iran so aggressive. And naturally, this is coming out, like you said, out of desperation. Iran is showing its anger. Now, the people of Iran, you had mentioned earlier, they are going through a lot. The people over there, the economy, the prices of goods and everything increasing. So they would want talks with the U.S. No matter what their reservations may be about President Trump, they don't trust him, but yet they want a de-escalation, right?
Definitely. Iran said it very clearly that they are ready to talks. But the point is that, you know, for the Iranian leadership, they have just reached to some sort of a historic agreement, I can say, with so many countries, United States, Britain, all the big and strong countries in the world, China, Russia, Britain, Germany, United States. You know, it was very difficult for Iran to sell out that agreement in 2014 and 15, but they did. Now it's very difficult for them that, okay, I have spent a lot and I have risked a lot to reach to that agreement. And now one party of that agreement is changing his stance, and he's imposing sanctions, and they have to knee down and go and negotiate with them. It's not easy for Iran. And they know very well that Trump is the president now, but maybe after a year or two maximum, he will not be a president. So maybe another one will come, and then another conditions will be there. It's very difficult for any country, not only Iran. It's very difficult for any country to reach to an agreement, international level of an agreement, and keep on changing that conditions from time to time. I think it's very difficult. Iran is trying its best to to keep its supremacy up to some level, even in the region itself. That's why they said that they are ready to talks, but there is some kind of conditions. They need to secure, I can say, the minimum level of conditions, minimum level of understanding with the United States that, okay, let us sit and talk, but at least the basics should remain.
Okay, right. So now we have with us online Mr. Hamid Khan from the UK. Thank you so much for joining us, sir.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.
Can you please tell us this new leak that's come out, this correspondence from the UK ambassador to Washington saying that President Trump's withdrawal from the Iran agreement was a reaction, and it was kind of basically because of its association with President Obama. Can you give us a bit more details about that, and what is the authenticity of this? What does it mean exactly?
Yes, that's right. Actually, it is part of the leaks which started in the beginning of this month from the UK ambassador in the United States, Mr. Kim Derrick. And there are so many leaks where he has mentioned that Trump administration is incapable to handle many issues. And right. Then there is a second episode of these leaks. It just came out this week. And it's the as far as this main issue is concerned, that Trump administration or personally Trump withdraw this deal in spite of the deal being done by President Obama in his previous administration. There is no such confirmation from U.S. officials in relation to this leak or in relation to this information sent by Kim Derrick, who has already resigned as the UK ambassador in the United States now, as due to this conflict raised in last 2 weeks by Daily Mail. And as far as the Trump's personal opinion is concerned, we all know since 2015 when this deal was took place between Iran and Europe, and Trump openly opposed that deal by Obama administration at that time as well. And as far as Iran and Europe is concerned, they are still staying on their word, and they are still agreed that they will carry on according to the deal signed in 2015. While Trump administration is not clear still, and Trump has, since Trump administration has withdrawn from that agreement, they are taking it as their policy towards Iran and put more sanctions on Iran. They are trying to stop Iran through more sanctions and trying to isolate Iran to stop their nuclear program. While on the other end, Iran has clearly told that these sanctions or any more sanctions will not be good for the region. Rather, Iran will carry on, or Iran can resume their nuclear activities again. As far as Europe is concerned, Europe wants to carry on the deal, and they are more inclined to give some relaxation to Iran rather than putting more sanctions. And while Trump administration is as far as this recent leak is concerned, there is no clear statement from Trump administration in relation to these leaks.
Thank you so much, Hamid Khan, for joining us. And that was a very interesting feedback that we got from Hamid Khan in the United Kingdom. Also, as a final question, Mr. Abdurrahman Mathur, I wanted to say that, okay, we've given the position of what's been happening that Iran has been doing, say, against other countries. But at the same time, Iran, how it's been affected, basically, that no Iranian oil, no country can buy Iranian oil. Now it's petrochemicals as well, and it's also trying to, the U.S. is also trying to block all the uranium enrichment programs, period, even for power generation and medical use or anything like that. Iran's GDP has shrunk by 2.9%. They have falling industrial production almost as low as their oil production. Their food prices have tripled, and they have a low medicine supply as well right now. And the citizens there are being affected by this. Now, if you look at both the citizens of both countries, they're If you look at the U.S. as well, you also have a nation that's weary of war after Afghanistan and Iraq and everything that their military has had to go through, the veterans and things like that. So where do you see all of this eventually end up? Do you see that in the near future that there will be talks?
Hopefully, because everybody is, you know, talking about talks and everybody is offering talks with some conditions, yeah, and hopefully there will be, both of the sides will be able to ease their stance to be able to reach to the negotiation table. But that reminds me of the history, you know. The situation is just like as if there is two empires and there is a conflict between two empires and everyone is trying to, you know, push the other one a little bit back, try to gain more land, try to gain more interest, you know. It is a conflict of the will, actually, mainly. It is a will conflict, and there is an Iranian dream to reach to the Middle East as maximum as they can, and there is an American reality. Americans are present in the Middle East, in the Arabian Gulf, since so many years. This conflict, there was some kind of, you know, understanding according to the nuclear deal, which was signed maybe 4 years back. But now, because there is a new situation, new scenario, a new Iranian expansion and a new American administration, that's why we see that this conflict now is escalating.
And hopefully there'll be a resolution to it sometime soon. Thank you so much, Abdulrahman Mathar, for joining us today. And viewers, after the break, we will continue our program and discuss our next segment about the Kartarpur Corridor talks that took place recently. Stay with us, please. Welcome back. Now we're going to be speaking to our guest, Dr. Rizwan, about the recent talks between the Indian and Pakistani sides about the Kartarpur Corridor and the developments that have taken place over there. Thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Rizwan, who is an international affairs expert. Let's talk about the talks that took place over the weekend. 80% of the modalities have been agreed between the Pakistan and India side. Now, can you get into a little bit of detail about what are the exact type of modalities that we're talking about in such a corridor that connects two countries that have such a high level of tension between them? There are obviously visa issues, there's so many things, how their visitors will be treated over here, the number who can come into the country, etc. So would you like to elaborate a bit on
that? Sure. The first ever concern that Indians shared with Pakistan was the security concern. Mm-hmm. And security concern, why the modalities have been set by both countries, because it's in the mutual interest of both the countries. And they were saying, actually, there are some people who do not want peace between India and Pakistan. That's common interest of India and Pakistan. And if such kind of groups or individual, they try to derail this kind of interaction between both countries, which is leading towards peace, that should be. And already Pakistan has worked a lot about it. Pakistani forces, security forces, they have countered terrorism in Pakistan very efficiently. And this is the message to the international community as well. Given this, they agreed about this, that they are satisfied with the security arrangements done by Pakistan about this corridor. And secondly, there were some other demands that Pakistan should construct a bridge on Pakistan's side.
Right.
And that bridge, actually, if you take, you see this corridor, it is a very huge project. They were asking 5,000 pilgrims should be allowed to visit Pakistan on regular basis.
And 10,000
10,000 on some special occasions, like Baisakhi and others. If you see such an inflow of, a massive inflow of the pilgrims, it is really challenging. And how to maintain this, for that you need some infrastructure as well.
And these pilgrims are due to come on buses of 15, groups of 15 people each and on buses. The Indian side has asked that it should, that should also be changed, that it shouldn't be limited to just them arriving on buses, that they should be able to travel.
There are some people who can travel by foot to Pakistan, because there are devotees who commit themselves, they will not be traveling by bus. They can go by foot. So this kind of things are still in discussion. And I want to say this corridor, actually, looking at the current vision of the Prime Minister of Pakistan, he was saying if we have some initiatives, this kind of initiative where people of both countries are interacting with each other, they can know each other. And it was seconded by the Foreign Minister of Pakistan, Shah Mahmood Qureshi. He said if people meet each other, they see each other, they come to know what are the common grounds where they can have talks, and there is a further there is further progress towards peace and stability in both the countries. And one more thing which the government is looking into, it is revenue generation from such a massive project. And this is still maybe in the next round, they will be talking about it. And not for the Indian side, in Pakistani side, because the Pakistani side may have some infrastructure where they can have some accommodation facilities.
How many days would the pilgrims be coming for?
It depends. Like sometimes it is for 2 to 3 days, or it may last maybe 2 to 7 days. It depends, because it's a small, you know, just see that the devotion of the people before opening this corridor, they were seeing from the through the binocular in Pakistan.
And so before there were no Indian pilgrims coming to Kartarpur Sahib?
They were not coming. It was not open, giving a visa free entry. It was
They were going to Panja Sahib and they were going to Nankana Sahib, but not Kartarpur.
And look, when the Navjot Singh Sidhu, he attended the oath-taking ceremony of Prime Minister Imran Khan and the Chief of Army Staff, General Qamar Javed Bajwa, they assured him that we are taking some initiatives which are going to promote bilateral peace between India and Pakistan. So this kind of thing, Sikh community, which is about 21 million Sikh community in India, is so much rejuvenated after listening this. They can, this is very holiest place for them.
And you know, and it's located in Narowal. Is it in that area?
No, no, it is in the border area of Pakistan. Lahore, when they come from this Atari, and they come to Lahore, then there is a bus service. It's about 127 kilometers from India, and about it it takes like the whole corridor, if you take, it is not so big. It is about 3 miles in its circumference.
It's 3 miles, right?
Three miles.
When they do arrive, do they have hotels and infrastructure like that to accommodate the pilgrims?
That is a challenge. You know, for example, devotees,
since they haven't been coming earlier, so there must be a lack of places to stay. Because Hassan Abdallah and all, they have adequate arrangements for years now, but in this area, probably not.
You are right. If you know, such a massive influx of pilgrims comes to Pakistan, they must have proper facilities. And even talking to another media, I was talking, there should be some guest houses, there should be some malls where they may have some things they can take back home, and souvenirs, and related to their culture.
Absolutely.
And one more thing, we also have a Sikh community. We should depute our Sikh community on that place. It will be giving them a gesture that they can have interaction with their brother Sikhs who are living in Pakistan. So considering this kind of thing, now Pakistan should develop hotels and some malls. This is a long-term planning, and in the short run, they are just talking of building a bridge and accommodating some refugees.
And naturally, the primary concern is going to be the safety and security of the pilgrims and the medical facilities as well.
Because some people who travel from that area to this area, they may fall sick. Mm-hmm. And the third thing is that their food and civic amenities will be available for them. Mm-hmm. Interestingly, since Pakistan's inception, there were some attempts from both sides. Mm-hmm. They were actually Indians. They wanted to swap land with Pakistan for just acquiring this Kartarpur area. Mm-hmm. And we did not agree about it because it's against sovereign sovereignty of Pakistan. So later on, this is really a great initiative where you see this post Pulwama, after Pulwama, it was not even anticipated that we are going to have this open border for the Sikhs even. Mm-hmm. And Prime Minister Imran Khan, he said, he referred to the Berlin Wall. Mm-hmm. We should pull down the Berlin Wall, mm-hmm. both the countries, people
which is
should
a huge
see,
statement. And how much work for this Kartarpur corridor has been made on the Indian side so far?
Indian side, actually, they are just giving a passage. The main thing is this the venue, the spot is in Pakistan.
They've made a four-lane highway and such.
Yeah, especially for the buses and mm-hmm. transportation. The main thing is here because people will be staying here. It's not a long distance. That's why they need to just make the road, and road, it should be like accommodating the transport coming.
So it
and
seems
going.
Like work, and 70% of the work on the Pakistan side has been completed as well as on the Indian side. So it looks like the November deadline might be met for Baba Guru Nanak's 550th birth anniversary.
I believe so, because looking at the commitment of the government of Pakistan and recent dialogue between both delegations, and it is coming out like very positively, both the countries agreed on 80% modalities. It reflects that both the countries are pretty serious about mm-hmm. meeting the deadline as well.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So now, are we expecting Prime Minister Modi to be there at the opening of this corridor? Because that is one point that nobody's quite sure about right now, because he's come into power again with a very large majority, and partly that was based on the anti-Pakistan rhetoric. So how is this going to all work out for Prime Minister Modi?
Prime Minister Modi is so unpredictable. Yeah, it makes sense. When there was election campaign, he was having anti-Pakistan rhetoric. I think so. He will realize this. It will be premature to make any statement about him. But if he really want to bring peace between both the countries and end this kind of hostility and want to increase people-to-people bilateral relationship, even it starts from the Kartarpur corridor.
Absolutely,
he
and it's
must
in both,
be there.
It's in both countries' interest. Thank you so much, Dr. Rizwan, for joining
you.
Us today. And now we're going to be speaking about the stock market and how that performed today. And we'll be shortly joined by Mr. Sajjad Mankani, who's our stock market expert, and he's going to be telling us about the recent movement in the stock market, if there was any. Sajjad Mankani, thank you so much for joining us on World Today.
Thank you.
Can you please tell us about the situation, right, the state of the stock markets today in Pakistan? How did they perform?
Today, market was very weak, and it slid by about 2%, mainly because of the expectation of rise in interest rate tomorrow when State Bank is going to announce monetary policy, and market is expecting another rise of 100 to 200 basis points. So this was the main reason why the market declined today.
And how about the rupee? Its further value has gone further down a bit.
Yes. Today, rupee almost was near rupee 60, 59, 80, 90. So rupee also shed from 58.80, 58.90 to 59.80, 90 in the interbank market. So this was also a cause of concern.
Are there any sectors in the market that are looking promising?
Look, under the present scenario where the interest rates are rising, only the companies that are rich in cash are going to benefit. And at the same time, those who are getting earnings in dollars, they are going to benefit. So oil exploration companies whose prices are related to, linked to the US dollar, they are going to benefit, and at the same time, some of the companies which are very rich in cash will definitely benefit because their other income will rise. Banking
right.
sector may also show some improved performance in the coming months.
Thank you so much, Sajjad Mankani,
You're
for
welcome.
Joining us today. And that's all for today's program. That's all that we have time for today. We'll see you next time on World Today from Sharmeen Ali. See you next time. Bye-bye.